This is Join Us in France, episode 403. Bonjour, I'm Annie Sargent, and Join Us in France is the podcast where we talk about France. Everyday life in France, great places to visit in France, French culture, history, gastronomy, and news related to travel to France. Today, I bring you a conversation with Jennifer Jerzyk about using Narbonne as a launching point to discover the Mediterranean coast. She has great tips about travel by train, and it's clear she really enjoyed Narbonne, the Languedoc-Roussillon. That's the old name of the area. Now it's called Occitanie. It's all been turned into one big region. We also talked about Carcassonne, Collioure, and a few other places. The complete list will be in the show notes that you can see right now if you're listening on your smartphone. This podcast is supported by donors and listeners who buy my tours and services, including my itinerary consult service and my GPS self-guided tours of Paris on the VoiceMap app. You can browse all of that at my boutique, joinusinfrance.com/boutique. Somebody left a comment about my Montmartre tour that I think is worth sharing with you. By now, there are quite a few comments on my tours, and I rarely read them on the podcast, but I like that this one speaks to the technology which I chose, which is VoiceMap. He or she wrote, "This was our first time using VoiceMap. I can say that Annie Sargent gifted us a great experience and a newfound pocket companion for her tours. The technology works better than I would have thought, with near pinpoint accuracy about where we were at a given time. The story was great, and the stories gave color to the area. Some tips. Try to stay close together with a group so that you also stay together on the audio. If you wander, make use of the map to tap where you need to rejoin and enjoy." Yes, well, you don't really need to stay together if you don't want to, but yes, it makes it easier if you want to stay at the same pace. I chose the VoiceMap app because I think they do a great job keeping the app clean, and also they don't spy on you, which is a good thing, I think. For the travel update, I'll give you a quick reason why people who take the RER between the airport in Paris and the city downtown Paris are asking for trouble. No news on the France bootcamp yet. More on that in September, but do save the date if you're interested. It'll be in Toulouse, May 21st until May 27th, 2022. Now, there is a newsletter to go along with this podcast. Right now, I only email once a month, if that, honestly. But when I email, it's always something that will help you next time you visit France. And also, if you're interested in the bootcamp, that's where you need to go. Sign up for the newsletter at joinusinfrance.com/newsletter. Bonjour, Jennifer Jerzyk, and welcome to Join Us in France.
Bonjour, Annie.
I'm very happy to talk to you about my favorite place in the world, the southwest of France.
Well, I was really glad to have the opportunity to spend a few days there and explore some of the towns.
Tell us first when your trip took place and if you were traveling with other people or if it was just you, that sort of thing.
I was in Europe for a work trip and wanted to extend it with a few days in France. So I was there by myself and spent a few days in three of the cities in the southwest. And this was at the beginning of April of this year.
2022.
Correct.
It looks from your photos that you had good weather.
It was. It was beautiful. It was beautiful the entire time.
Excellent. Okay. So you went to Narbonne, you went to Carcassonne, and you went to Collioure, which are all lovely places. I assume you had a car?
I actually did not have a car. I really love traveling by train, and I am now over 60 years old, so I qualify for the SNCF carte d'avantage senior. So I purchased one of those in advance, which got me 30% off the train tickets automatically, which makes it a really great deal. So I used the train exclusively to get around. I think I rode a bus a couple of times, but mostly by train.
Very nice. Yes, those cards are really great because with the SNCF, so that's the official train company in France, you can get great prices if you book very early. But if you don't have a chance, if you didn't know that far in advance that you wanted to do this, or if you weren't sure of the dates or whatever, then you may qualify for a discount card, either as a family or as a youth or as a person over 60. And so these cards, you usually have to pay a little bit to get the card, but then you get discounts. And since you're buying last minute tickets, usually when you do this, 30% is a lot of money. I mean, not millions, but you know, it's a good amount.
It is. It was a great deal. And the app on the SNCF's website is fantastic. I downloaded it to my phone and you can just use it from anywhere. It's very user-friendly. It's all in English. So you know exactly what you're doing. You don't have to print out any tickets because the conductors just come by and look at your phone, just like they do here. And yeah, I highly recommend it.
Right. I cannot highlight this strongly enough and recommend this strongly enough. When you're traveling in France, use the official French train app. I know there are others. Don't talk about the others. I want to talk about the SNCF Connect app. If your phone is in English, the app will install in English, which is what you want. And you can buy your tickets directly from the app. You can change your tickets directly from the app. If there is a strike, you'll be notified of that in the app. It is absolutely perfect. 90% of the people who get freaked out about strikes in France, that happens because they didn't buy their ticket from SNCF. They bought it from some other vendor who is going to keep them in the dark. Thank you very much. So don't do that. Make the French app work. It's wonderful. It works great.
That's a very good point.
And did you indeed book at the last minute most of your tickets?
So I was coming from Nantes down to Narbonne, and I booked that ticket in advance. And then as I was at the end of the trip, I was leaving out of Barcelona. So I also booked the ticket from Narbonne to Barcelona early on. And so it was extremely reasonable, particularly with this additional discount.
Yeah.
But the day trips, which were all on the regional trains, I think I could have boarded the train and purchased the ticket. I just did it the same day. And none of those tickets were more than 10 euros a piece. It's very reasonable.
Yes. And it used to be, I'm not sure if it's still possible. On the TGV, I'm sure it's not. But on regional trains or even grande ligne trains, which are like the long distance trains, we still have quite a few of those. You could just show up at the train station, get on the train and go find a contrôleur. How would you say that? The person who checks your tickets.
And the conductor.
The conductor. Yeah. And buy your ticket there from the conductor. The only thing is you can't be sitting on your seat and wait for the conductor to come check you.
There
if you do it that way, you will get a ticket because you didn't buy a ticket. You know, you're a fraudster. But if you by yourself go find the guy and say, I'm sorry, I got on the train late. I want to buy a ticket now. You can do that. Well, you used to be able to do that. I'm not sure if it's still true, but I would guess it is because French people do that all the time. They just hop on and there you go.
Well, I didn't test that out.
No, I don't recommend you test that. But it's that flexible. The train is that flexible. When people get used to the train, it's like they just go when they're ready to go and that's the end of that. All right. So let's talk about Narbonne a little bit. What did you like there?
You know, I loved the size of the city. It used to be a much bigger city way back when. And I will point out, it's an extremely old city. It's a Roman city established in 118 BC. There was an amazing archaeological dig that I just kind of wandered into called the Clos de la Lombarde. Wish I had spent more time there. They've recently opened up a historical museum called the Narbonnia, and I would go back there and spend time there and learn more about the history. But it was a medium-sized city. I would compare it to a suburb in a metro area in the United States. So not too big, not too small. Like I said, easy access by train, very reasonably priced. I got an Airbnb. I went back and looked at how much I paid for $43 a night. That was a one-bedroom apartment near the center of Narbonne with a full kitchen, a bathroom, a washing machine, which I was in week two of my trip. That was nice to be able to wash a few clothes. It just checked a lot of boxes. It was 10 miles from the Mediterranean, and you could hop on a bus and go down to the beach. And then it was this great jumping off point to go see many other cities in the Southwest easily. So it was kind of that like cruise ship mentality where you drop your bags once and then you just go out and keep exploring something different every day you're there.
Which is a really nice, Narbonne is an excellent point to do that because there's lots of different things around there. And I think you even listed them on your notes. You know, you could go to Béziers, you could go to Nîmes, you could go to Montpellier, Avignon, Agde, Sète, Perpignan, Port-Vendres, Banyuls-sur-Mer, Barcelone. I mean, and of course you have others. If you have a car, you can go to many more places around there that you can visit. The train doesn't necessarily go there, okay? But if you have a car, there's even more. The sky's the limit. There's lots to see in that part of the country.
Exactly. But I was kind of keen on showing how much you could see without renting a car. Because let's face it, it's expensive to rent cars. It's a little bit anxiety producing because you're driving in a foreign country. And then gasoline is a lot more expensive than what we're used to. So, you know, it was really fun. And plus, I just think the trains in France are a huge pleasure. They're quiet. You have a seat. It's a very relaxing experience to ride the trains.
Right. So did you get the TGV? Did you go first class? What did you pick?
On the TGV trains, I did go ahead and spring for first class because there isn't that much difference in the price. It's a very small bump up to get a first class, and then you get a little bigger seat. You usually have a place to plug in your phone. Sometimes you're getting a little table so you can set your food or your work or whatever you're doing there. You can pretty much spread out. So it's a lovely experience.
Now, one thing that I've started doing recently is instead of, because when you board a train, TGV train, you have areas where you just put your luggage. And, you know, people worry about their suitcase being taken, whatever. And it's never happened to me, but I suppose it could happen. So what you can do is bring a little lock. They make these locks that have like a piece of wire, and you could just lock your luggage to the metal grate where you put all your, and then you don't worry about it. I have an Amazon page with products that I recommend. So I'll just add that to that page and I'll put a link to it in the show notes because, you know, it makes it so simple to just peace of mind that, oh, my suitcase is locked. Nobody's going to take my stuff.
You know, I will say over decades that I've traveled in France and Europe, I've never seen anyone lock their suitcase to the place where they set it down.
No, it's not something that most people do, but you can. If that's going to worry you, you know, you can.
Sure, sure. Yeah. It could. Yeah.
Okay, so you enjoyed Narbonne very much. One thing that you did not do that I think people might consider is to have a meal at the Grand Buffet, is what it's called. And I'll put a link in the show notes again. It's an all-you-can-eat restaurant with just French specialties. Now, we were chatting before we started recording that, well, tell me what you told me, because this was funny.
Well, I tend to be a little bit of a food snob. And so I did extensively research restaurants in Narbonne and all the places that I was going to see where I might want to eat. And of course, Le Grand Buffet features prominently, like, oh, everyone must go. And a lot of the properties that I was going to stay at mentioned, oh, you're only 5 minutes walking from Le Grand Buffet. And when I looked at their website and I looked at what it was, it looked like an all-you-can-eat buffet. And I just thought, oh, that I'm a single, you know, I'm traveling alone. I don't want to sit there and gorge on food. I would rather have a beautiful meal that is brought to my table and enjoy the service and whatnot. So I did not go to Le Grand Buffet, but I could see it's something very popular in the area. But you've gone there, so tell us what that was like.
So it's constantly full. So you have to book well in advance. Like I wanted to go there last weekend and I looked a week early and it was full. Especially July, August, when people are driving through France, this is a destination kind of restaurant. It's a nice dining room with white tablecloth, comfortable chairs. The price is just under 50 euros per person. I think it's the same at lunch and dinner. I'm not sure. And you can park reasonably close. There's even electric chargers, I checked, not far. So it's made for people to come and enjoy a long lunch or a long dinner. So what they do is they give you this buffet of appetizers. Okay, so you have all sorts of appetizers, but they are all of the regional foods of France. You choose an entree or two or three, whatever you'd like, and they will bring them to you. So that's the part where they bring it to you. And then they have cheeses. The cheese course is like ridiculous. There's like 300 cheeses always on hand. So if you want to try all these different regional specialties, this would be the place to do it. And when we ate there, it was delicious. It was a lot of food, but you don't have to eat it all, obviously. Just be selective. And I do remember having a really hard time picking, but we didn't walk out of there feeling like we were going to barf. This is not, you know, we didn't do that, but we could have if we had wanted to. But it's a nice experience, and it's really the place to go try. You know, if you want to try, I remember this is the last time I ate a frog leg. I had not had frog legs for years. And I was like, oh, so it was one of the appetizers. So I just grabbed one to try it. So if you want to have one escargot, one frog leg, whatever, you can do that because they have it all. And it's good quality food. This is not the cheapest, like fill you up quick kind of food. It's good food. So it's something to consider. I would recommend it if you're curious about French specialties and regional foods that you've never tried. If you wanted to try a little bit of tripe, go for it. You can have a little bit of tripe right there without ordering a whole dish of tripe. You know what I mean?
That sounds like the perfect reason for going there is to sample a bunch of different things.
Right.
I think I've eaten so much French food that I know what all of those things are. So I had an absolutely amazing, for me anyway, dining experience at a restaurant in Narbonne. And it's not a Michelin-starred restaurant. It wasn't even written up in anything. I just happened to be walking along the Canal de Narbonne, which runs right through the beautiful center of Narbonne. And I noticed there was a restaurant called, correct my pronunciation, L'Estagnol, the Spanish place.
Yeah, I think it's L'Estagnol. Yep.
And they seem to have a lot of fruits de mer as featured item on their menu. And I love those cold seafood plates. You know, we pay a fortune in the United States for those kinds of things. In Europe, in France, along the coast, this is just like what people eat. This is just normal fare.
Yeah, yeah.
I think I sent you a picture of the beautiful plate of cold seafood, and that was what I ate for dinner. So I noticed it as I was walking by this restaurant that they were going to have a winemaker there one evening, and that she was going to be sharing her wines, and you could buy them and so forth, and then presumably eat at this restaurant, or there were a couple of other restaurants participating. So I came back at that time, and they explained to me that she was going to set up her little table. It was kind of in an alley with no traffic. It wasn't an alley. It was a nice walking street area next to the restaurant. So I went over and you had to buy a whole bottle. You couldn't just buy a glass of wine. I bought a bottle of her wine, which was lovely. It was a rosé. And then I brought it back and sat down at the table, which was just a few steps away. And as I started eating, I started hearing music. And I was like, oh, this is great. This is like a whole event here, like a pop-up event almost taking place. And sure enough, there was a band, which was mainly percussion, but also musicians playing sort of at the other end of this street. And they spent about a half hour down there. And then they walked up to the end where I was sitting and continued to play for another half hour. And I don't know if it was the surprise of it but it was just an absolutely delightful experience. And the people in the band looked like they were having a blast. The music was loud. It was not background music. I mean, you had to pay attention to them. But they only played for about a half hour. I was finishing my dinner by that point, so then I left. I don't know what happened afterwards. But to me, this is why you travel, because you can't plan that kind of an event. This was something where you arrive, you see what's going on locally, and then you just jump in and participate. And it turns out to be like one of the most memorable things that you did during that particular trip.
Indeed. You know, that's why it's important to stay downtown. French cities, French downtowns are alive with things. If the weather is good, there are going to be things happening in the city center. And if you decide to stay, you know, further away or go back to your hotel because you wanted to save 20 bucks and you wanted to stay at a hotel further away from the city, you're going to miss out on these things. So don't do that. Stay in the city center because that's where it's happening. And you even texted me, you asked me if I knew the name of this, and I couldn't remember the sort of music that they were doing. Couldn't remember it. But then you had taken a picture of the poster and it reminded me that it's called a bandas. And they are very, very common in the southwest of France. I'm sure they're common in the southeast as well. It's usually a dozen drums and a few trumpets, maybe saxophone. Not quite a marching band, but they can march a little bit. And most of the time, it's the drums playing. And then sometimes the other instruments will join in.
Well, it was a real delight, a highlight of the trip, super enjoyable. And the weather was just picture perfect. That always it makes it wonderful.
Since I do itineraries with people and I help them plan their time, often I would like to find things like that ahead of time, but you can't because it's something that's thrown together like at the last minute because one, COVID, and people here are very, we've had real shutdowns where like you plan a whole thing and boom, it's shut down. Nothing's happening. And it could happen again. We could have a big spike and have a city decide, nope, this weekend, nothing's happening. So that's the first reason. And also because people are more spontaneous here and they don't update their websites, honestly. The only way I can have information like that is if I call the tourist office and I say, next week, what's happening? And then they can tell me. But if you call them 6 months ahead, they don't know. And trust me, it's happened many times when I've had a customer who is insistent that they want to know, this is just an example, like they want to know where to go for Christmas mass on Christmas Day, but they want to know this in April. And there's no way I can tell you that. They don't know that yet.
It does underscore the importance of stopping in at the tourist office. And granted, they don't know everything, but they know a lot. And if you're looking for something specific, it's definitely worth a stop and a conversation with them. And most of the time they speak English and can help you out. The time in Narbonne can't underscore enough how that's a beautiful town with not a lot of tourists. I didn't see any tourists, quite frankly.
The other good thing that you can do in Narbonne before we move on is that you can rent little electric boats to go on the Canal de la Robine or further if you rent them for longer. So it's a lovely place to rent a boat and do a little canal trip for a day or a few hours or a few days. You know, they have different options.
Yes, I wholeheartedly agree. And I did want to do that. I just didn't allow myself enough time. So that would definitely be on the list next trip. And I believe there's many towns in France or small cities like this that have water running through the middle. And they all have these little electric boats. They're very popular. It's not only in Narbonne. It's in many places. So let's see. One of the following days, I hopped on the train and went over to Carcassonne, which, of course, is a world-renowned site. And I have to say, even after reading about it in advance, people's descriptions, I was absolutely blown away by this medieval city. Mm-hmm. I mean, this truly is one of the great UNESCO sites in the world. It surprised me that the actual medieval city that's up on the hill, the walled city with all the towers, it's still a functioning city. People are living there. You can go stay there, you know, stay in an Airbnb or a hotel. They even had a 5-star beautiful hotel with a swimming pool and a gorgeous garden and a Michelin-starred restaurant. There were amazing things inside of this ancient walled city.
Yes, it's a great experience. Honestly, I would not spend several days there, maybe one overnight, but that's it. You don't need, I mean, after a while, it's all the same. I mean, you just took the train and back, right?
Yes. Correct.
And did you feel deprived, like you didn't get to see it all?
I would certainly enjoy an overnight there and spend more time in the town, the Bastide town below. It's a great contrast between two of these cities side by side. The old walled city where they were clearly just trying to protect themselves from invaders versus the English-style Bastide city, which is laid out on a grid. Kind of very organized, and you know, they're what, 20 minutes, 30 minutes walking apart from a historical perspective, and on many levels, very, very interesting to go there. And it's not, you know, it's not near, what's the closest big city maybe Toulouse? It's sort of out in the country, if you will, but also on a couple of rivers. So there's a lot of water running through there. You can see why it was a place where that people wanted to build a town. Oh, it's on the Aude and the Fresquelle.
Yeah.
And then the Canal du Midi goes through it as well.
Well, Canal du Midi doesn't go to the Cité de Carcassonne. It goes not far.
Not far. Okay, but in the area, yeah.
Yeah, it's an outstanding place. Honestly, if you've never been, I know people say, we've said it's touristic and everything. Well, yeah, there's a good reason why. It's also outstanding. That's what it is, you know. Now, I poo-poo it sometimes, maybe in my tone, because I've been there so many times. I live like an hour away. So obviously, it's the obvious place to take people who visit us. And so I've been there hundreds of times. So, of course, it has lost a little bit of that first time. But every time I go, it's enjoyable. It's just a beautiful, beautiful place. And there's good services. Like you said, there's star restaurants. There's a great hotel. L'Hôtel de la Cité is very nice. It's fairly easy to park. You have to pay, but, you know, it's a really good place to visit for a day or possibly an overnight.
One of the things that I read about it afterwards, it is that it is one of the top sites to spend Bastille Day, which is coming up here in a couple of weeks.
And you reminded me, I had forgotten, but you said, you know, oh, it would be cool to go stay at one of the hotels along the river and have a balcony over there. And I was like, why didn't I think of that? So I'm going to try and find one. This is 9 days. So I will try and see if I can find one. But that would be fun, right?
I was going to say, you may have to book for next year, I'm guessing, because that's got to be the most popular thing in the area to do. And granted, you wouldn't need a hotel. I mean, it would be nice, but you could just stay. There's a lot of places along the river there. I'm sure that gets filled up with people coming to watch the fireworks.
Packed, packed, packed. And yeah. The tourist office even gives you, I mean, I just found a thing where they say, les meilleurs points de vue. So they tell you where to go see it. And it is, it's outstanding. It's beautiful. But there's lots and lots of people. But seeing it from a hotel balcony, now that I would like.
Wouldn't that be neat? Plan in advance. That would be super, because to see the fireworks going up over the top of that medieval city on the hill would just be an unforgettable experience.
Yeah. I mean, that's why it attracts so many thousands and thousands and thousands of people. It draws people from all over the world, really, but also locals. We also like it.
So I don't know if you want to pause here, and I would just make a reminder, because whenever I leave the comfort of where I'm staying, I have to remember that you must take toilet paper with you everywhere you go in France when you're out traveling, because you cannot be assured that there will be paper. And so anyway, pack your little packet of Kleenex and lots of them.
Yeah, Kleenex and hand gel.
Hand sanitizer, yes. I mean, there are bathrooms, but you just never know what you're going to be finding when you're out and about touring.
Yes. Yes. I like to have in my day pack, I like to have little wipes. It's important not to put these wipes in the toilet, but rather in the garbage can, because, you know, but yes, it's very good to have. If you know you're going to be touring, take some.
Yeah, take some with you. And then the other thing that I was reminded of, which I don't know, I guess I just haven't run up against this as much as I did on this particular trip, was the need to have small coins, small euro coins with you at all times. Because even though I know you're a fan of Apple Wallet and I love to be able to charge everything because it's just easier, it just seems like I run into a lot of places where I need a euro for this, I need 5 euros for that. And it's hard to get small bills and change in France. And at one point, I think I was in Narbonne, I walked into a bank and I said, can you give me a bunch of coins for this 10 euro note or something? They were like, no, we can't do that. And that is a surprise to Americans who can walk into any bank in the United States and get change.
You're right. This is a service that banks provide to businesses who pay for a business account. So if you are a restaurateur, they will provide you with cash, they will count your coins, they will do rolls of money and all of that. But if you just have a checking account, they don't want to do that. If you have a free checking account or no account at all, they definitely don't want to do that, because it's just, they have to manage all this, all these coins, and it's more work and they don't want to do it. So if you're visiting, when you withdraw cash from an ATM in France, sometimes they let you choose what bills they will give you. And if you're not sure, ask for, just withdraw 40 euros, because they'll give you two 20s, and 20s you can use anywhere. 50s are harder to use, and bigger than 50, don't even think about it. If you order cash and your American bank asks you what denominations you'd like, you want to go for 20s, because that's easy to use anywhere, just about.
Or smaller, I would say. That's what I get. I try to get all fives if I can. Usually, American banks are not going to have single euro. Well, they're certainly not going to have coins, but I try to get all 5 euro notes before I go.
Yeah. And if you can walk, I mean, if you have a 20 and you go buy, I don't know, a piece of cheese or whatever, you know, or bread and cheese, well, you'll be left with, I don't know, 14, 13 euros. And so that's cash, you know. So that's how you break it up, is you go buy something. But don't use big.
That is the way to do it. And so, Annie, can you comment on, like, if I went into a store and bought something with a 20 euro note and I'm due back, let's say 15 euros, if you ask them to give you all single euro coins, would they do it, or would that be annoying to them?
Don't ask. Don't ask. Take what they give you. The end. Because, again, it forces them to make a trip to the bank to get more coins.
Right.
And since they're a business, they can, but that person doesn't want to, you know, no, don't.
Yeah.
Don't ask.
So anyway, it's something you need to just sort of be conscious of in trying to, you know, don't just give those coins away. Those are very useful for very specific things. And so if you get coins, save them, because you'll need them for tips or getting on a bus or something.
Yeah, and you know, you can have just to bring a little coin purse special for your trip. And if you're someone who uses a lot of cash in the US, then you'll probably want to continue using a lot of cash in France, which is fine. But plan for that. I'm someone who doesn't use cash hardly anywhere.
Oh, I try not to. Yeah, but when you're traveling, there are times when you do need it.
But nowadays, you can ask to add a tip on top of your credit card, which is what we do now. But you have to ask. It's not like there's a line for the tip. When the person brings you the bill, you just say, can you add 5 euros for a tip? And they will.
Yeah, I guess I have done that. I guess I have done that. Yes, you should do that. Try to charge as much as you can, because it is hard to get the espèces, as they say, the coins. And it seems to be in short supply.
Yeah. Let's talk about Collioure a little bit, because our time is running short.
It is. It is. And I cannot say enough about this absolutely gorgeous town. And I have talked about it with some French people that I've run into locally back in the United States. And they just swoon. When you mention the name of this town, they absolutely swoon, because it is so beautiful. The whole setting is just gorgeous. And is it touristy? Yes, it is. But in a nice way. I don't know. First of all, it's very easy to get to on the train. Again, the regional train stops there. You're at no more than 5 or 10 minutes to walk right into the downtown gorgeous area that is surrounded by these small hills filled with vineyards. And I guess they've got their own AOC for their wines. I tasted a little bit of their wine, but not a ton. I did not have the anchovies, which I guess are very much a specialty.
Yeah, I love them. But they're very expensive there. They sell them for too much. I've had anchovies everywhere I go. I love anchovies. But yeah, but whatever. You're visiting. Have some.
And I was only there for the day, but there are many, many places to stay. Hotels, Airbnbs, you know, just lots of places to stay. It would be a pleasure to go back and spend a longer amount of time there. But it was in Collioure that I also had one of these sort of unique travel experiences that, you know, if you don't wander off and just go check something out, these things don't happen to you. So I had gotten there early in the morning, weren't a lot of people out yet. I walked down to the beach and there was a little cafe on the beach out from the center of town. And I noticed, first of all, I said, can I get a coffee? Yes. And I said, do you guys have croissant? Nope, they didn't have that. I was like, what kind of a French cafe is this that doesn't have croissant? But they didn't.
Well, it's one where they showed up late to work is what it is.
Maybe that was it. So anyway, I had my nice coffee and I'm sitting there and I notice there's like a group of children and there are some tiny little sailboats out on the beach. And these kids are all putting life jackets on and, you know, doing what kids do, you know, goofing around and so forth. And I said to the waitress, so what are they doing? So they're going to teach them how to sail. And I got this look of horror on my face, like, what? These kids couldn't have been more than 6 or 7 years old. And
yeah.
I was like, you're going to put them in those tiny sailboats and send them out. Granted, this is a little bay that's very protected. The water's very calm, but there's no way that you would put a small child in a boat by themselves and go out. And
really?
There were only a handful of adults. So I'm watching and they take them all down by the boats and their man is giving them these lessons and talking. You could tell he's pointing out the different parts of the boat. Well, what they wound up doing was he went and got like a motorized boat and then they loaded the kids in two to a boat and they attached them all together. So it was like a little train. And then he pulled them out into the bay. So they're, I guess they are quote unquote sailing, but they're basically being pulled by this little motorized raft that he was.
Right. So probably this was their first day because this is a day camp situation. And so they have
right.
people to teach the kids. And the first day they do that, the next day they let them loose. And this, they will pull them and then let them loose in the middle and then attach them again and then take them back. And then after that, they can go by themselves. Once they have the certificate that they've passed the thing, they can go by themselves.
Do they have to know how to swim? It just looked kind of like a dangerous activity for small children.
I'm not sure what all the rules are, but they're being watched. They have people.
Yeah.
There's even a diploma that you can take in France to be that sort of instructor with kids. It's under control. And most cities along the water will have this sort of thing. And of course, again, people who do itinerary reviews with me, they often ask me, can I put my kid in that sort of thing? They don't speak French. It's all in French. It's not only locals. You could be vacationing from Paris in Collioure and your parents could sign you up, but at least you speak French. If you don't speak any French, these guys, they know how to teach sailing. They don't know how to teach kids to speak French.
Right, right.
But this is normal.
But, you know, just from a visitor standpoint, I mean, this was like the most adorable thing that I saw all day.
Yeah.
It's so cute to see these children out in their little sailboats. And then as I walked around the bay, I could still see they're out in the middle of the bay in the boats. And it was very cute.
It's very fun. And, you know, I mean, this was not summer. Right? Oh, I forgot. You told me at the beginning.
No, this was the beginning of May. So I presume school was still in session. So maybe this was a field trip or something.
Probably a Wednesday. It was probably a Wednesday because on Wednesdays, French kids don't have school. And so they do day camp type things.
There we go. That's probably what was going
probably.
On. Probably. Yeah.
That would be
right.
my guess anyway. It's totally normal and it's fun because that's one of the things that you get to do when you grow up by the beach is you get to learn how to sail.
Learn how to sail.
Yeah.
It was very cute. Very cute. And so along the same lines, I ate lunch at a beautiful restaurant with a gorgeous view overlooking the bay in Collioure called Navon. So the sail. It was just fantastic. I think I had squid in a special sauce. And it was absolutely phenomenal. The glass of wine. I could have stayed there all afternoon and they would have let me. It was just fantastic. It was just fantastic. There was a Michelin-starred restaurant there, and I stopped in and I said, I'm just one person. Do you have one place? They looked at me like I was crazy. They're like, of course not. We are full today.
The starred restaurants, you really need to book in advance. And sometimes even the ones without a star, you need to book in advance. It just depends. So it's worth doing a little bit of research ahead of time and looking at the Michelin bib website to
Absolutely.
See if there's a bib restaurant in the area, but that you would have to do a month early or something like that. I like to try the Michelin bibs.
A good value.
Right. And also the Michelin stars, it takes even longer. And sometimes you get to places where we were at one recently. Actually, it was a bib. It wasn't a starred. And when we got home, my husband made himself a dish of pasta because he was still hungry. I was fine, but it wasn't enough for him. But granted, this is a thing where they told us to want 3 or 4 or 5. You could get 6 courses. And I decided on 3. I thought he would go for 4, but he decided to go for 3 as well. And it wasn't enough for him. So you just need to know that some of these places, if they offer 6 courses, it's probably because if you're hungry, you probably need the 6 courses. Because they're not going to serve you huge portions. No French restaurant will do that.
No.
Yeah. So let me just mention that all of these places that we've mentioned today, Narbonne, we did a whole episode about that with Elise. It was episode number 163. Collioure, it was episode number 262. And Carcassonne was one of the early ones, 23. So if you want to know more about each of these places, and of course, they've been mentioned many times in trip reviews with different people. Definitely gorgeous places to see in the southwest of France. Would you say, so what sort of group do you think these places are best for? Like Narbonne, would you recommend it more for very young people, for older people, for everybody? What do you think?
You know, I talked to people in Narbonne, and most people told me that Narbonne is sort of perceived as a place for retirees, kind of for older French people. Now, who did I see out at the cafes? They were mostly 20-somethings. They were younger, 30-somethings. They were younger people. So it doesn't have a university, so you don't have that sort of like built-in set of very young people. So yeah, I would say that probably skews a little bit older. But I met no Americans. I saw no American tourists. Maybe there were in Carcassonne, but honestly, I didn't see them. It was people from Spain, it was people from Germany, maybe Italians, but I did not see any Americans in any of these areas.
Well, and it's really important to mention that because if you've been listening to the podcast, we're always telling people to come south, to the southwest in particular, because we don't get that many visitors from the US. We get some Canadians, but mostly, like you mentioned, it's going to be Italians, Spanish, Germans, some English, but, you know, it's going to be Europeans visiting and French visitors as well, because these are places we like to go as well, right? If you want to practice your French, get out of Paris and come south, southwest especially, because there's a lot to do, lots to see and lots to enjoy.
Indeed. I wholeheartedly agree.
Jennifer, thank you so much. It's been lovely talking to you. I'm sure it will inspire some people to come visit the Southwest. And I hope to meet you in person. Are you one of the ones planning to take the French boot camp with us? Your French sounds like it's good.
It's good enough to get by, but I'd love to improve it. So yes, I would love to do the boot camp. I've got that marked on my calendar for next year. So I hope to join the group that's going to get together for that. Sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's a lot of people. I finally got through all my emails and a lot of people want to do this, which is going to be wonderful.
Good.
But it's going to take some planning and some organizational skills here because it might be a lot to handle. Anyway, we'll have fun. Well, thank you very much, Jennifer. And well, hopefully I'll meet you at the boot camp.
Take care.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Again, I want to thank my patrons for supporting the show and giving back. It was wonderful on vacation to see that so many of you signed up and want this podcast to continue. Patrons get several exclusive rewards for doing that. You can see them at patreon.com/join us. That's P-A-T-R-E-O-N. Join us, no spaces or dashes. Thank you all for supporting the show. Some of you for many years. You are wonderful. And a shout out this week to new patrons. Let's see if I can say this list of wonderful people without butchering their names too much. Caitlin Stella, Maxine J. Schmitz, Colleen Radford, Lara Hitchcock, Charlie and Morgan Runner, Anna Diamski, Anne Hall, Linda Zack, Maddie Sols, Karen Hurrybutt, Liz Riviera Goldstein, Juan Paez, and Darlene Amdahl. thank you so much for becoming patrons and making this podcast possible. Also, welcome back Brian Sumner, who had to update his credit card information. This happens a lot. People stop being patrons because their credit card expires. And by the time they realize it, they often email me saying, oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't realize. No need to apologize, but I do appreciate those of you who take care of that little detail of the credit card expiring. My thanks also to Wilft Rogers and Esther Leto for sending in a one-time donation by using the green button on any page on Join Us in France that says Tip Your Guide. Esther sets hers up as a recurring because, yes, you can give a few dollars every month to this podcast if you enjoy it week after week. And thank you very much. Elise, let's talk about your Patreon for a minute.
Oh, okay. Let's talk about my Patreon. My Patreon site is called Elise's Corner.
Right. And you can find it at patreon.com. That's patreon.com/ Elise Art. ELYSART.
Yes.
And then what you call it, Elise's Corner. But Elise's. If you type in Elise's Corner, you're never going to find
it. No, it's Elise Art. It's Elise Art. And Elise. It's just a way of saying, I listen to what you do and I appreciate what you do. And it's wonderful to hear from people. It's wonderful to know that the work is appreciated. And yep. I would like to give a nice little thank you to a couple of people. And that is to Lynn S., to Linda, to Glenn, and a very big thank you with a big hug to Robert G. from Manhattan. And to add to his thank you, I need to say thank you, thank you, thank you for the big bottle of champagne.
Ooh, nice.
So that's another whole story. But if you enjoy my participation in the podcast, it is a wonderful way to show that.
Yes.
And coming up, I think I'm going to be doing a little bit more of a survey and some questions about what you like to look for on markets, outdoor markets, the summertime. Of course, there are markets all over France, but in the summer, there are zillions of them. And having spent a lot of time in the last month and a half being with people who do markets, I'm sort of curious to know what you look for.
Yeah, what
when
you look
go.
For, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Patreon's wonderful because it's a way to let podcasters, lots of podcasters do this, right? It's a way to let them know that you enjoy what they do and also to interact with the podcaster directly. So if you want to interact with Elise directly, do it through Patreon. It's, again, patreon.com/ Elise Art. Merci.
Merci, Annie.
If you're preparing a trip to France and listening to as many episodes as you can to get ready, keep listening to the podcast because it's a great way to get ready. You can search the website as well and just choose the episodes that you want to listen to first based on what they're about. But if that's not quite enough and you would like a little extra help, you can hire me to be your itinerary consultant. Here's how it works. You purchase the service on joinusinfrance.com/boutique. Then you fill out a document to tell me what you have in mind. We make a phone appointment and we chat for about an hour. And then I send you a document with the plan we discussed, usually the next business day. I've done this with a bunch of people and, you know, it really helps me as well as you because it forces me to organize things in a way that makes sense. I plan on continuing to do this. But this service is usually booked up far in advance, although because we're heading towards the colder months, it's coming down. So I'm booked about 4 or 5 weeks in advance right now. So that's really good. But if that's too late for you and you can't talk to me because I'm all booked up, you can still take me in your pocket by getting my GPS self-guided tour on the VoiceMap app. I've produced 5 tours of Paris and they are designed to show you the different iconic neighborhoods of Paris. And I understand maybe you've never used an app, but like I said at the beginning, people who've never used those apps really enjoy them. So give it a try. You'll like it. For the travel question of the week, I want to tell you why people who take the RER between the airport and Paris are kind of asking for trouble. Now, I'm not making this up. A guy who just retired from driving that train for decades was interviewed on French radio, and he talked about why they have so many problems with that line. He said that unlike London, where it's only direct trains between the airport and the city, in Paris, the RER makes stops. Some of those stops are in neighborhoods that are not great. Drunks fall on the tracks, people throw stuff on the tracks, and even if nothing like that goes wrong, the train makes several stops between the airport and Paris to pick up new riders. What happens when the train stops? People get robbed. I know a lot of Americans don't take trains, and so that's probably why you never think about this. But anytime a train or a metro stops somewhere, there may be someone looking to grab something of yours and run out. The doors close and you can't go in pursuit. This is robbery 101. My laptop was taken just like that on a regional train in Spain. This was years ago, okay? But this guy must have noticed me, that he could grab my laptop and run. And when the bell rang announcing that the doors were about to close, he grabbed my laptop and ran. And I couldn't do a thing about it because the doors closed right behind him and I was stuck. I was very lucky that a Catalan lady on the platform saw the whole thing and she alerted security immediately. I mean, she started screaming. I could hear her from inside the train. They stopped the train from moving on and some of the security people went in pursuit of the guy. Once I was out of the train with all my stuff, the train left and a security guy brought my laptop back within about 15 minutes. He was a young person. He ran and the guy eventually just threw my laptop on the side of the road because he didn't want to get caught with it. I was really lucky because these were the days when I didn't have all my work in the cloud like I do now. So I had months and months of work on that laptop. It would have been devastating to lose it. At any rate, this happens a lot. If you have a suitcase, a carry-on bag, and a backpack, which was my case, you are easy pickings. Now, this is what I think. If you're not traveling super light, and by that I mean a small carry-on, not too heavy, and one bag that you can zip up and carry around your body, then the RER is not for you. Because also getting around the security gates to be in and out is really awful. And besides, it's packed, it's smelly, it's hot, it's a miserable experience. Most locals would rather not suffer through that. I don't know why so many visitors insist on taking the RER. You're on vacation, take a taxi from the official taxi line at the airport. No need to reserve anything, just get on the next taxi. In all fairness, I will also mention that every two or three RER trains between Paris and the airport are direct. If you're on a budget and you must use the RER, wait for the direct RER. It will slow you down a bit, but it will reduce the odds of you getting robbed. This week in French news, well, a lot has happened since I did an update after the episode. This summer in France has been unbearably hot and dry. When I came home from Spain, all the grass in my yard was dead because we weren't allowed to water. There were severe water restrictions put almost everywhere in France. The person taking care of the house and the dog and the cat watered pots and the young trees, but anything that didn't get water every day died. It was scorching hot and it really didn't cool off at night very much at all. So it was between 95 and 105 for at least 10 days solid. Then it would go down maybe for a couple of days and then right back up for days on end. There were devastating fires in a lot of areas of France. Firefighters from all over Europe came to the rescue. For some reason this year, France got hit worse than other places. It's now all under control because as soon as it stopped being so hot, huge storms happened. And this is like the last 2-3 days. Heavy storms with lots of rain, wind, lots of things got damaged. In Toulouse, we didn't get a lot of rain, but in Paris, they got hammered. The metro flooded and everything. I'm not a climate scientist, And that's probably why I have no problem telling you that this is what climate change is doing to France. And I can say that with confidence because that's what 99% of climate scientists are saying. We have to speed up our transition to clean energy. And thank God this is not a controversial statement in France. All the news shows that cannot interview politicians, since they're mostly on vacation, this is August after all, they interview climate scientists and firefighters and people like that because we've had drought, this terrible drought and fires. All these dried up rivers, lakes and ponds have everyone worried. Even Brittany and Normandy got slammed with really hot temperature. We broke all records this year. What this means for you who want to travel to France is that more than ever, do not book any accommodations in France that do not have air conditioning if you're coming between June and September. And always plan on things you can do if it's inhumanely hot. Indoor places with AC preferably, but also churches, caves, those sorts of places, beaches, lakes, whatever. I feel really terrible for the hedgehogs, the foxes, the birds. You know, I'm a softie when it comes to animals. All these animals are dying because of this heat. And we really, really have to do better right now. Whatever you can do to stop burning oil and gas, do it. And for the love of God, do not vote for any politician. We're not going to change anything. Inaction is not an option. Now, for my personal update this week, I had a wonderful, relaxing time at the beach. It wasn't as hot in Villanova as it was in Toulouse. I did the drive in my electric car. It was perfect on the way to Spain. On the way back, I got a little daring and I wanted to try new stops and new charging stations. And it took forever to get home because not all of them worked. I didn't get stranded or anything, but it took more time than I had planned. Live and learn. I love the car. It is really comfortable. I'm never going back to gas of any sort. At the beach, I swam every day. I walked a lot. I think I mentioned before I went on vacation that I have a bum knee. My left knee is getting older and I need to see a rheumatologist and I'm probably going to get some kind of, I think they call it viscose supplementation or something. Anyway, but my appointment is not for another month. So my bum knee really said, oh, slow down, woman. You're swimming, you're walking. It's too much. I really need to spend more time riding my bicycle because the knee should be okay with riding the bicycle. Do you think that can be arranged in France? Bicycling? Yes, indeed. Show notes and a full transcript for this episode are on joinusinfrance.com/403. Use the transcripts. They make the website really easy to search. And you can help your Francophile friends plan their visit to France by going to joinusinfrance.com. Click on the share buttons on the side and tag your friends. They will thank you. Next week on the podcast, an episode with my friend Elise Riven of Toulouse Guided Walks about Victor Hugo. What an interesting man he was and what a wonderful author. And we'll also talk about places in France where you can see where he lived and things like that. Send questions or feedback to annie@joinusinfrance.com. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you join me next time so we can look around France together. Au revoir.
The Join Us in France Travel Podcast is written, hosted, and produced by Annie Sargent and copyright 2022 by Addicted to France. It is released under a Creative Commons Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives License.